Now we're live.
Now
we're live.
Yeah, we are.
Sweat Equity Podcast. We're going to do it live on Facebook, our Facebook page, to kind of incentivize people to kind of go over there, watch when we're going live. You get that little tweet. You get that little notification that we're going live. And
it's very exciting.
Very exciting.
I'm just popping out right there.
You popped out. That's Eric popping out.
Farts.
I'll work you down
Sorry.
A little bit.
That we got sound like shit.
We got editor-in-chief of Creative Loafing, Tampa, Scott Harrell. Let him hear you.
Hey, here I am.
And we got friend of the program.
Director extraordinaire.
Directing this episode.
El Presidente.
That would be me.
President of 208 Monkeys, Mr. Damian Alpizar.
What up, y'all? How y'all doing today?
He looks like Manny Ramirez if he never played sports.
Or now, maybe.
Yeah. Or yeah.
How's he look now? We don't know.
Probably.
I don't know.
Yeah.
If he did like the Sammy Sosa lighter skin thing.
Whoa. That's creepy.
He'd get closer
dude.
To Damian.
The Sammy Sosa thing? I don't know what happened there, but there's something wrong with that doctor.
Or something right, depending on how white you think white is right,
yeah,
right?
Then again, I'm not agreeing with that. I'm saying maybe he nailed it. Sammy's the nutso one.
You're the
know.
One who looks like American History X, man.
Yeah, you know, you keep saying that. Quit saying that.
We'll stop curb stopping people. I won't do it. All right.
My hair is just sad when it grows out. Okay. Shut up.
It's like it's sad. It's got it's emo more than sad, I think. But
tomato, tomato.
I was just listening to a story. Well, first we got officially. Get the podcast started.
Yeah, hotty toddy, let's go.
Oh, no, we got to do a real one. It's Friday afternoon, and we're having some beers. We're having a hang sesh, so I'll do a real hotty toddy. Are you ready, Scott? Are you ready for this?
I'm ready.
Have you listened to the podcast?
We put him on the
Eric
spot.
Eric keeps putting me down, but it just comes back like
nobody's going to say they hate it to your face.
Toddy. God almighty. This is the Sweat Equity.
Worst one yet.
Yeah. That's the best, man. You got to get a little fired up. You're alive. You're alive, right? Right?
I'm already fired up. Let's go. Sorry.
Okay. You got some cocaine going through your veins or something.
What? I actually do not. I feel like I have to say that.
So.
Jesus.
I was, it is Florida after all. I was watching a video last night of Neil Patel, who I think former Google guy, Google exec, and it was about content online. It made me think about what I wanted to talk to you, Scott, about while you're here. Is I want to hear your story of how you got to where you're at, because I don't think we've had you on to where you've talked about that.
No.
And then, you know, I feel like a lot of things. Journalism is really tough to do now.
Yeah, it's changed a lot. It's also very fluid, but people are sort of scrambling to figure out how to do journalism.
Right,
now.
Right. And what's authentic and what's real journalism? To me, I used to have New York Times and Wall Street Journal as my two pillars of like, I'm not either left or right, but these two seem to be the staples of like legit journalism.
Sure, yeah.
Call it 10 years ago; those were my two. I go to those two all the time, and now I feel like both have jumped the shark, and I don't even know what to read anymore necessarily. But to bring it back to what I was looking at last night, so Neil Patel is a Google SEO expert. He does these videos on LinkedIn. They're actually pretty great for the digital hustlers that are listening to this podcast. I would recommend following him, but he's talking about basically doing the Deadspin Gawker media formula. Find someone who does an article legit, who does all the research, wrap your opinion around that, mm-hmm. put that the researched legit article in parentheses and quote it and link back to that, but put your opinion around it, get at least, you know, 300 words on it of your opinion. On that, on an opinion of an opinion,
yeah,
essentially,
yeah. It's reactive journalism.
I knew you'd have a good name for it. And then it's that thing of like, and then Google School with that too, mm-hmm. which is that was what's really interesting because they used to go, if you duplicate content, Google's gonna just it's basically gonna give you negative points.
Yeah, it hurts you. Yeah.
Call it fantasy points, SEO fantasy points, right? You're going to get negative. You're throw a pick, basically. Huh. If you do that, now you're saying you're not going to get negative, but you're not going to get anything out of it unless you do this part. And you link it back to the legit first article, because then it's – and I get it, because Google's like, okay, because you're going to read this piece, you might go hit that link and go read the real article, sure, or case study or whatever it is.
It's like value added for – They're going to keep you online.
We're keeping you there, yeah, right? We're keeping you in the tail. We can track that tail, too, and see what you're interested in, because eventually it'll lead to either you drift off or you're going to click on something that's a lead gen or leading you down a marketing funnel for a product, right?
You see the new Elon Musk proposal to have a website where people go on and rate journalists? What do you think about that, Scott? Were they like...
Like Politico?
Yeah, well, I don't know.
Rotten Tomatoes.
It's kind of Rotten Tomatoes for journal. It's more of the trustworthiness, I guess, of the article. You're not really rating how good it is, if it's legit or not.
It'll start that way, but it'll quickly, I imagine.
Yeah, those Russian bots will take over.
Well, it'll be like a Rate My Teacher kind of thing, you know, where people just who have a certain, you know, opinions about news will just start slamming people. And
to me, it sounds like more tools for trolls. I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, exactly.
It might be.
Exactly,
I don't know. I think they're looking for something to kind of track everyone because of all the fake news that goes out, you know.
I think I'm fine with it, because, I mean, I work in alternative media, so I'm, you know, I'm probably never going to win a Pulitzer.
Nobody's checking your facts.
No, I think I know what that means. Practice good journalism, but we...
What's alternative media? How would you just... Because people would ask alternative comedy, and I'm like...
It's hard to describe. The easiest way to describe it is to go back to the beginning, before the web. Alternative newspapers were basically started for two reasons. They were either A&E listings of punk rock shows and off Broadway plays and stuff that's going on in your community, and then the other ones were the ones who were fact-checking your local mainstream media papers. Like, almost all the stories were about the stories that the dailies weren't talking about.
Interesting.
And covering, you know, like, if a daily is not talking about something the mayor's doing, then the alt-weekly would call attention to that. They were basically watchdogs of the mainstream media.
Right, but had usually a way less readership
product. It definitely... you know, back in the 50s and 60s, when, you know, dad was reading the paper every day, he didn't want opinions. You know, he wanted to know what was going on, and alt weeklies came out of opinions, and definitely a sort of, I don't want to say every alt weekly ever was lefty, but I mean, that's the gist. You know, that's what most people associate them with, and they were progressive, and they were about social justice causes and stuff like that.
Guns and Op-Ed, that was the only alt-weekly that I used to read, so it was pretty good. A lot of guns.
Wait, where did you get your hands on one of those?
A gun or the paper?
The paper,
no,
weirdo.
I'm kidding. That doesn't exist. I was trying to think of, like, what would a right-side kind of alt-paper be.
Well,
like?
I mean, there, you know, if you went to big cities in the early 70s, there were a lot of right-wing publications, but they... didn't have a design aesthetic. But like, the people that started alt weeklies were by and large creatives, and the right wing people would just make it basically a zine, you know, like typeset an angry rant
right.
to something.
Yeah, I mean, so how do you see? I guess what's your opinion on current journalism? Like, are you pissed at a lot of stuff that you see? Because I get angry. I'm not even in the industry, and I'm just like, this is clear. Because I know the digital side of all this stuff, and I can see how it works. And I'm like, everybody kind of knows what clickbait is now.
Yeah.
But the whole thing, like this Cambridge Analytics story, right, is misrepresented. The whole story is like, it sounds like Facebook was doing something evil, and it was actually the other way around. It sounded like Facebook had a leak, and it was the other way around. Is Cambridge basically scraped and stole a bunch of data.
Yeah, but nobody knows who Cambridge Analytics is, but everybody knows the word Facebook,
right.
So you're going to work it into your story.
They're the monolith, and thus we hate the man, right? And so, and it's always, if you're punching up, it's always kind of a good angle, I feel like, because most people feel like they need to. I hate when people say that in comedy, too. You should be always punching up, and it's like, I don't know if that's the best way to go about it.
Sometimes it's really, really fun to make
fun
of people.
I'm just saying, if that's your number one angle.
Yeah.
or number one mantra of how you do anything opinion based or whatever art you do. I don't know if that's the best thing.
That's not truthful. That's just, you're just doing it to do it then.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Like, it's not what you really feel necessarily.
I do my comedy to just bore people, just get them really sleepy, just get them real tired. Ooh, I'm popping.
It's going to come in handy soon with them kids. And now your daddy doing 10, right to bed.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I'm doing dad puns all night. And yeah. They're like,
I do it too.
I don't
though.
Know English.
You have like a fake brick wall in the kids' room.
I can hear my wife's eyes roll at some of the puns I'm doing. But she's in the other room. Like, and I was doing like Three Little Pigs and I was trying to make it fun for me. And then she's like, oh.
Just giggling to yourself.
So where do you see what? I'm sure you've got something that's bothering you with the mainstream media kind of thing. Words.
Well, I would say all media. I mean, it's just really sad.
Nice.
What I mean, like it. It's true.
I was hoping you didn't go. No, it's all good.
No,
then I'd be like,
No, there's a lot about news media that's really really depressing, because people are being forced by the environment to, like you say, shape stories in a certain clickbaity way or cover stuff that really doesn't need to be covered, but you have to get your 80 blogs a week up, or, you know, and there's not a lot of resources being expended on more long-form journalism and more in-depth studies, because there's just no time and no pay to send somebody out for a week to dig through police reports and FOIA requests and... And again, I'm definitely not a hard news journalist. I never claim to be.
No.
That's not my beat. But even in whether it's soft news features or hard news, you don't have the time anymore to really, really tell a compelling and original story.
Gotta
it's really sad.
Gotta get it out now.
I believe the term
yesterday.
Flaccid news, not soft news. we're girthy or
flaccid.
First
dick joke at what time is it?
Oh yeah, how
Let's
long
see
we
here?
It?
Write that down.
That's a little late for us.
I know. No use of the word girthy yet either, and I'm the first one. Okay. Weird.
You know.
That is a little strange. We're a little slow.
Sorry.
Is it anybody's girth day?
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, so. Yeah.
Save the puns for your kids.
Yeah, the girth puns for my. For
I'm
my
totally
going to
use it
my
later.
My daughter was like, huh? But I would say, all right, let's flip this more over to kind of careers in journalism. We always try to make this show more pragmatic advice than anything.
Yeah, sure.
And I'm sure you get hit up all the time. You're the EIC now. That sounds like a badass rapper.
Editor in chief.
Yeah, but
I knew that.
And so Mazel Tov, by the way.
Thank you.
It's huge.
Is this new?
It was bitter. This is the last couple of months.
It's awesome. Congratulations.
Thanks. Yeah, the paper was our parent company, who's owned the paper probably 7 or 8 years now, sold it to another media group that specializes in alt weeklies. And they made some budget cuts, and frankly, we had a couple of layoffs. And I was offered, David Warner, our old editor-in-chief, basically fell on the sword to save some other people's jobs because he had one of the bigger salaries. And
seemed
so
like a good
thanks,
dude.
David.
Yeah, he seemed like a good dude from everything I read. All the writers that worked there, that stayed there, you wrote something really nice, a bunch of other people I read at the time. And he sounded like a good dude that was really a martyr in a way in your kind of community.
In my opinion, yes, I would say that. He's worked in alt weeklies a really long time, and he really understood the heart and soul of it was community, and that extended not just to coverage but to the newsroom. And he was my mentor for a long time, and we didn't really get along so well when he first came to Creative Loafing, because I was the hot shit music writer and I didn't want to listen to anybody, and I was like, new guy, I'm not going to listen to you, new guy. And he was like,
we're not doing that article about Real Big Fish. All right, man. That's not punk. A lot of those
fake punk.
Yeah, a lot of those arguments. I'm sure you get a lot of people that are like, hey, I want to be a writer.
Mm-hmm.
Damian gets it a lot on the video side. I want to break into doing graphics or animation or product photography, video production. And sometimes you just don't have enough time to email everybody back and all that. I have enough time, so if you want to hit us up at la@tocoworks.com or eric@tocoworks.com, we'll probably get back to you.
Maybe.
Yeah.
We'll see.
Yeah. Maybe we'll answer it on air, which I like doing.
Yeah.
That'd be cool.
Well, we want to change this more into part of the show or just break different episodes up into maybe interview, and then the other one, us hanging and taking in calls live. We were just looking at how you can do Facebook Live, and people can almost kind of like a call in, but they're doing FaceTime with you.
The Getherd show, I think, really sort of pioneered the idea of Skype calls,
really,
which seemed to work really well. They probably didn't pioneer it. They probably use it better than anybody else, I would say.
We'll have to check that out, because in comedy, you don't want to steal any jokes, but in business, I'll steal any ideas.
Yeah, absolutely.
And try to do it better.
I mean, that's not crazy. Skype calls? We just technically would have an issue.
Yeah, no, I just...
We've looked at it to try and, like, figure out how to make it on the big screen TV back there, and it's just, like, looping background. It's just...
Oh, it's a time thing more than anything. It's just time. We just don't... We're working on a lot of stuff, and I'm 9-to-4 schedule, like, strict. So I can't come in here as much as I used to do some of these fun things. But I would say the big thing is with that Facebook Live, though, it's way more interactive. It's like that HQ game. Remember I was talking to y'all about that?
Yep.
It's like a game show at 3 o'clock every day.
Oh, right, where you, like, call in or, like, join into the live game show that's only happening at that time online.
Right, and it's like there's a pool of money as a prize, and if you last through the 7-8 questions...
I haven't heard of this. This sounds pretty brilliant.
It's awesome. It's actually, like I don't do it, but the idea to me is insane. Like, I think it's brilliant. I think it's the way things are going to go, like, live engagement, because live... is the only thing that's kind of connecting. Like, live sports, you see it, like, that's the only thing on the TV, on the networks that are...
The only reason to have cable.
Right, exactly. And they know that now. They didn't know that, like, 4 years ago.
Right.
They thought, oh, well, we've got these ABC shows at night that no one really watches until they're streaming on the cable providers, too, now.
Yeah. And Chicago Hospital.
Right, yeah, Chicago. Always Chicago something.
What is going on in Chicago?
A lot of murder, Chirac.
Yeah, the emergency room is always busy.
That's true, actually.
Wheeling, it's a sibling.
More shows coming.
So I think HQ, I see that when our friend of the program, Samantha Gann of Social Alchemy, she was showing me that. I was like, it's like, whoa, that's where everything's going to go. And that's where I want this podcast to get to. Not a game show necessarily, but I was thinking more Loveline for, you know, kind of nerd business or business advice or... any kind of hustle thing. Damien, you've been kind of quiet. What's going on?
I'm mixing over here, bro.
Oh, you're directing.
Wicka, wicka, wicka.
My job is to make sure you look pretty.
You look like you had a point you're about to throw out there.
Is that why you're so quiet? You're working hard?
Well, you know, hardly working. Look good. I got to focus in on that mug right there. Boom. Beautiful. See how I did that? Yeah.
Good.
See, ratings just went up.
So even with this camera and the way it's interacting, it can automatically do it if we calibrate it correctly. But I feel like journalism is going to start to kind of, it's already doing it a little bit where you have to be, you can't just write anymore. Like, I talked to comics, and you can't just do stand up.
Would creative loafing ever go the way of, you know, live podcasts about subjects that, you know, you have in print and then indulge in that story further? Is that something that...
By the way, we didn't tell Scott we were going live before. Yeah, before this, I was like,
"This is fine."
I don't know if that was cool or not.
No, no. I we're always looking for new ways to tell stories and ways to engage the community. But again, like the whole journalism industry is like this giant freighter. You know, it takes a freighter like 14 miles to make a turn, and so you have this whole industry trying to figure out which way to turn, and it's going to take forever to turn, and B, they still don't know which direction they want to turn in yet. And there's always a matter of resources. You can't fill the paper every week and fill the website every day. And also, you know, I do like a live town hall, you know, for an hour.
Yeah, that's great.
And answer every email about people that have really great story ideas, you know, with on the resources that most newspapers have right now, because the resources are definitely dwindling.
And the stories could suffer from somebody donating extra time to something that's not their writing. It's a weird line to walk.
Time management is a huge issue in journalism right now, because it's butting up against productivity.
Well, time management in journalism has always been, it's always been story, get to press, and there's always this window of diminishing time, it seems like. Everything that I've ever seen, whether it's real or not, because obviously TV and movies, you know, maybe they, you know, fantasized.
Yeah, it's romanticized to a
certain degree. But at the same token, though, I've actually been on working with magazines that had to get things released for, let's say, fall. And it seemed like fall was only 3 months away, but fall seemed came
15
very
minutes
quickly.
Later,
yeah.
The deadline
it's
was
like,
there.
What? Yeah. So with everything being so on demand, especially when it comes to, you know, people tweeting things now and so on and so forth, you know, how's that landscape changing, you know, the stories that you put on page?
I think that the real sea change is going to come when nobody's printing paper anymore. I think that's when the news outlets will finally realize that they'll have more time to spend on video hangouts, and they'll have a little more time to spend on doing some research, because the person that's writing print stories will be able to shift over to something else. And print is our biggest expense. Actually, printing the paper is Creative Loafing's by far our biggest expense. And
you could kind of see it over the years if you lived here. And Creative Loafing's in Atlanta, Charlotte.
Those are the only two now.
Okay. Yeah. But like they've been there over a decade, right, in each city. Mm. And you can kind of see it used to be like on the corner, every corner in a major area. And now it's like specifically.
You have to go to the cool coffee shop.
Yep.
Yeah, to find the coffee. Yeah, distribution.
The $5 coffee shop.
Yeah, distribution has slimmed. The number of issues that get printed get slimmed down. The Creative Loafing Atlanta just went monthly for their print issue. And they're concentrating more on web. Our the Euclid Media Group, the company that bought us, is very, very bullish on web, but they're not willing. They're like me. They grew up reading alt weeklies and playing in punk bands and all that shit. And so they want to keep a print product as long as possible.
Right.
But I think that they also understand that it's coming.
I think you got to go like vinyl, right?
That would be
great. Stone tablets.
I would love to put out an issue of Creative Loafing on vinyl. Well, that would be amazing.
There's that.
Literally on vinyl.
Literally.
Yeah, I was listening to all
now
this, the
newspaper read to you by Scott Harrell.
I'm not going to read it. I'll get somebody with a sultrier voice to read it.
Damien.
But I think it still has its...
I'll audition.
It'll still have its nostalgia. I actually personally, like I used to make fun of our lawyer clients because they'll print out everything in email.
Yep.
And they'll read it on a piece of paper. I used to make fun of it, and now I find myself printing out more stuff again. I went when I worked at my first job at a mutual fund company. I print out Bill Simmons's sports report, like 5,000-word mailbag, and I go in the bathroom and take a shit. Just be sitting there.
Take a shit. Why'd you put that in air quotes? Because
I didn't even poop. I poop before work because I'm a hero like that.
And you still haven't had a hemorrhoid, just sitting there reading.
No, I have healthy poops. I don't push. I'm literally sitting there with my pants on the seat. My pants are up on the seat.
Ew.
Just reading the.
That's gross.
Is it grosser than your actual ass on the seat?
No. Well, I don't know.
He's talking. It's gross for your jeans.
Dude, it was like millions.
Find somewhere else to read it. Is what my you know.
When you're stuck in a big corporate office where they're tracking everything you're doing, like, and I was the grunt of this whole group. The only place you could go was the bathroom. Everybody who was
men do that for privacy in their own home, especially when they have wives and kids.
Oh, I do that.
Yep.
Yeah,
absolutely.
This going to take a little bit longer to pass. Oh man, it hurts. What's my Facebook saying?
So I print out. I do top cover and bottom just in case it printed the wrong way. I'd print something legit like a mutual fund snapshot. On like a sandwich. Well,
just reading, the report.
Right, just reading about emerging market fund and the value is really good on this. And then in the middle would be 15 pages of Bill Simmons' mailbag, and I go and just read that. Now I used to make fun of people who print it out. Now I'm back to printing out stuff because I can't concentrate a lot of the time because there's a tab right there on Chrome or Safari or on my phone, or something pops up. And I can't read what I want to read a lot of the time.
Yeah, there's a million distractions with online reading. I agree. I like picking up the paper. I like picking up the St. Pete Times.
I like a book.
The paper.
Like I like a hardbound book.
I've gotten Kindle was a lot. I got used to my Kindle very quickly. I still like to read a physical book, but I'd like to travel a lot too. And the convenience factor is just insane.
Taking
three books with you, you know. Yeah. But no, I there's just nothing. Like having the tactile product in your hands. I totally agree.
No, I like, we had an intern in here and she didn't take it, but I like giving books Even though I consider my books on here trophies, like look at what I did.
Look what I read.
I read all half of those probably. Yeah. I bought all
you
of them.
You did buy them.
I bought all maybe. Of them. Maybe. For sure. But like I used to call them little mind trophies. Like, hey, look, you know, I'm not just a Natty Light drinker. You know, I'll read a Tim Dorsey novel for fun. That's what I do. But or Carl Hyacin, those are my favies. Those are my guilty pleasures. But you guys know who that is.
Quarterback at University of Miami, Tim Dorsey.
Ken Dorsey.
Huge Carl Hyacin fan.
Yeah, Carl Hyacin, he wrote the book Striptease, right? But the movie didn't do it justice, really. No.
That was based on a book?
There's no...
My brain is going to explode.
A much better book.
I almost didn't say that because I was like, it's going to bastardize Carl Hyacin. Yeah.
And Burt Reynolds.
Oh, Burt. I mean, you can't bastardize Burt Reynolds.
He was actually the best part of that movie.
Right. So, or... Dimmy's fake
and
titties.
The tits. But
yeah,
I'm looking,
but Bert. Yeah, sure, Bert.
Check out this thing I saw about. It's called TimeFlip. It's a time management dodecahedron, and it's this big ball. It looks like a ball, but it's.
Would you mind turning that to the screen for the viewers for a second?
It's a Dungeons and Dragons die.
It's like, yeah, it's like a 12. I think dodecahedron is a 12-sided. Yeah, that's why I don't know why you're telling me to do that.
I'm just trying to see what happens.
But this thing's cool because you can rotate it. And you assign sides. So if you put your email side up, it like gives you an alert when your time's up doing email. Then you rotate it in a different way. I don't know. I thought it looked cool.
I think that's kitschy.
For idiots,
I don't
maybe.
Know if that'll actually work, right? Like,
I don't know. Would it? I mean, I looked at it. I was like, that's so
it.
Stupid. And
Let's
then
try
I was
it.
Like, maybe I could
Let's
use
try it
that.
Out. Try it out. We'll try it out.
Try it out.
Time flip.
How much
send,
is it?
Send one to Toco Works, and they'll try it out and podcast.
And I'll love it. I swear.
So you spoken like a true editor in chief who knew how to get a plug in there.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Well, I mean, the thing we got to make money somehow. We gotta get some money going into this machine.
Hey, we get stuff sent to us all the time.
Yeah.
Yeah. Sometimes we write about it. Sometimes we don't. But yeah, we get local beer sent to us all the time. Of course, we're going to write about local beer.
What's the best and worst thing y'all have gotten?
The best thing is definitely Jameson sent me a Caskmates bottle that was aged in Guinness barrels. That was probably the best thing I've ever been sent.
Yeah.
And again, I don't ask for this stuff. I don't solicit this shit. The worst
Integrity.
Thing.
It's interesting they can send booze. I feel like there'd be a rule against that, right?
You can mail
right?
booze. It's
like
crazy.
You can just straight up.
Do y'all? You can have booze as an advertiser, right?
Yes, we can. We don't have a lot of liquor advertisers, but it's legal.
There's weird rules with like TV, radio about that.
The cigarettes.
There's rules. Yeah, with cigarettes and liquor, out. You can't be within like 5 pages of content that's for children.
Oh, weird. They judge it by pages.
Yeah,
that's
the
weird.
Distance.
That's
That's the distance. That's kind of like having a liquor store by the schoolyard.
Yeah, it's the same idea, I guess.
Huh.
It's interesting.
Can't have cigarette ads like near a cartoon, for instance. It's like a federal statute.
Joe Camel.
You probably can't have like a call to action. Like cool cigarettes can't put like a cartoon, and then like, hey, check us out in five pages.
Yeah, Joe Camel Wink. Changed all that. The Joe Camel character. Made all these laws come into effect.
Isn't it weird though that adults, adults or children? That's my kind of theory now. Is like we're all kind of not, we're all man child children a little bit. Like it's not like if this was 40 years ago, we'd all have mustaches and been back from the war kind of thing.
That's the big secret of life,
right?
You get to be our age, and you're like, oh, nobody knows what the fuck's
but
going
you,
on.
You ever look at pictures of guys our age that 40, 50 years ago, they look
they
like
look
they're
old as hell.
55
yeah,
does.
Seen some shit.
Yeah. So
yeah.
Like,
really. Hard life.
I'm literally wearing board shorts and a tank top on a Friday at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and I haven't cut or shaved my I haven't cut my hair or shaved in like 7 days or something like that. I haven't gotten a haircut in a month. I look at those pictures. I'm like, those are like, dude, those are men.
And yeah, imagine like in the 40s and 50s, if someone had said, we're gonna put out a magazine for adult men about playing video games. that's just not. That would not be a thing.
Or you're gonna watch. You're gonna have a thing called Twitch TV that's gonna make a fuckload of money, and you're just it's all people watching other people play video games. That still
adults playing video games.
Right. And look, I think there's value to video games. Don't get me wrong. I think you can. It's good for your brain as like a strategy thing. Like I think it helps you like playing chess. I think it can help you in other ways. But when it's a lot of your life, that's when like, I give Damian a lot of shit for comic book movies and all the nerding out he can do on that, but he'll also fire back that all the shit I love about college football is probably way too much, even if I do try to justify it by having a podcast.
It's all the same storylines, just different situations.
Right.
There's how many stories total that Vonnegut says?
Five great stories.
Yeah, there's only five, so they all fall into that, you know, everybody dies at the end.
Wow, that took a dark turn.
Sorry.
It's the clouds outside. It's like everyone dies.
It's really dark out.
That's how it goes, man.
So we always like to ask anybody that's kind of in a good position career-wise, you know, what's a good advice you give out, you dole out? Say someone's in high school. Hey, I'm graduating soon because it's May. Just graduated. I'm not going to college, which I think is smart.
Mm-hmm.
But
I agree.
How do I break in? How can I, what do I do? Or, I'm sure you get a lot of people that try to ask advice through someone else, right? Like someone will be like, hey, my nephew wants to do something.
There's a lot of that. I get a lot of stuff from people directly too.
So what do you say when someone's like, I want to try to get into being a writer?
Well, I definitely would say don't try to break into print journalism. As don't make that your be all end all career goal right now. I don't think that's a good idea. I would say DIY it, whether it's your job or not. You know, learn to code, put out your own website. I would try to make it look a little bit better than a blog, and find new ways to tell new stories that that other people in town aren't writing about. You know, I get pitches that are just the same, you know, the same, you know, I want to interview Mayor Kreisman, you know.
Yeah.
Well, you know.
He's the cool mayor.
Clearwater? We've done it to death. Do you read the paper? You know,
right.
Like, pitch me something that you haven't seen in the pages or on the site. But
yeah.
also make sure that you have something out there that we can go to and be impressed by. I mean, that's really the... If you write me and you don't send me clips, I don't even write you back.
Do you guys
send clips of, like,
it doesn't even matter if it's for another major publication. At least send me a link to your website, you know, where you have actual writing.
Oh, they say, like, figure it out almost, like.
Well, no, they're just like, how
just trust me.
How would I go about getting to write for Creative Loafing? And it's like, well, that tells me that you probably haven't written for anybody,
right?
You know,
right.
Because you don't have any idea how to pitch.
Oh yeah, or like you're probably not doing it on your own because you're kind of doing pitches. In another way, you're kind of pitching ideas probably to your friends a lot. I'm going to try to write about this.
Well, write about it. Don't don't go. I'll write about it when somebody gives me the green light.
Right,
ahead, put it somewhere.
So you want to see assertiveness in that direction? You know, I always compare. You know, do what you want to do for free until you get paid, kind of thing.
I go back and forth on that. I wouldn't do it.
It's a catch-all.
Yeah,
phrase.
I wouldn't do it for someone else, for free, unless you're interning or you've decided that's what you're going to do. I wouldn't want somebody to feel forced into that position.
Right, right.
But I mean, assertiveness goes a long way. My first professional job, writing was. I was in bands in the early 90s in Tampa and St. Pete, and the guys that ran the State Theater, the No Clubs guys, every other week they put out a very well it was a zine, but it was a very well put together zine.
Uh-huh.
Good art, good cover, and there was a guy that was coming to shows all the time who was he was a local musician himself, but he ended up editing the thing. And he and I got into a conversation on a drive up to Gainesville to play, and I just started bugging him about writing.
Yeah.
And I was like, let me write. And he just, at some point, somebody else dropped out, and he threw me a couple of jobs.
Do you guys actively scout new writing talent?
We don't. I mean, we definitely know. Somebody always tell us, like, I read the Minaret, or I'll read, is it the Crow's Nest, the USF paper, and you'll see the people that are
the up and comers
that are standout.
I gotcha.
And sort of have
their chops.
Should
be called the bullshit.
That's good. Write that one down.
Much better.
Write it right down right now.
This is why I'm the Don Draper of the digital community. Yeah, I'm getting cocky.
Sorry.
My dad pun skills. I would say
not really a pun.
Assertive, yeah, bullshit. Assertive.
You have an editor in chief here, okay? Grammatically, you need to be straight.
Technically, that's a pun.
Yeah.
What? What?
Suck
what?
That.
The
suck
bullshit. Oh, I thought wow. you were saying
suck
Don Draper was a
pun.
I'm sorry. You're right. Bullshit is an.
You know what? You need to really load up the podcast because we're really low on dick jokes and girthy. So please hit us with a
So how many dicks do you see in an? I would say. The advice you're giving back is kind of similar to what everybody says. Mm. It's I hear Damian say it a lot too. For people that are interested, it's the thing of like, you know, be assertive, do your own stuff. Like if you really want to do it, you'll do it. And you're not going to be good. Know that you're probably not going to be that good. But there are a lot of people on the other side. I think what a lot of kids need to know is that just like you were saying, like. Hey, when are you going to let me? When are you going to let me? When are you going to let me? A lot of managers are maxed out a lot of the time. They're not proactively thinking, like Eric was asking, are they proactively looking for talent? Sometimes it's just, you know, being there is enough. It's the Woody Allen rule.
Yeah.
You know, 90% is showing up kind of thing. That's how I got a lot of, like, stand-up gigs when I was, like, 21, was I was just not a douchebag, and I would hang out in the back of these open mics or shows that I wasn't on, but I just... be like, how can I do that? But I wasn't like, yo, let me get on this show. Like I saw a lot of people do that. I'd just be like, you know, what's the path? You know, try to be really polite and courteous and wait till the show's over and all that shit. So
it's like everything has the hard knocks one way or another, whether it's sitting at the comedy club for hours or just writing your own blog. You're gonna earn it some way.
Yeah,
you don't just get handed
anything.
If
you have a choice, write the blog.
Yeah.
Sitting in the back of the club, not that fun.
Stand up is a lot of work.
Stand up is a lot of sitting around.
Yeah, but you're right about right place because there'll be people who'll check in with me every couple of months or whatever. You know, I'm still looking to see if you need any freelancers, and I won't talk to them for a while, and then one day there's the news story that nobody can go cover, and I'll just pull somebody that had clips whose cover letter didn't have a million typos in it.
Wow.
And be like, hey, can you go do this? You know, and it's kind of like a trial by fire. That stuff like that definitely happens.
It really has to do with that whole sticking in your brain power.
Yeah.
You know, you got to sit there and say, we tell people, it doesn't matter what position they do on set, they want to get on set. PA is the most sought after. It's a gopher. It's not a glorious position, but it's...
Everybody could like you.
Everybody gets to know the person, and everyone asks, so what else do you do? And it's like... Just because you're there and you're constant. And people are like, hey, I remember that guy. Joe is a recent PA that we got on set. And he's like, hey, remember that guy? Who's that guy who was running around, who was like really like energetic, who was there all the time? You mean Joe?
Easy
Joe,
to work with.
Yeah, Joe, yeah. Easy to work with. Yeah, let's get him on this next one. Let's get him on the next one. And then eventually he got in the position that he really wanted. But that took just being in people's ears and being in their consciousness. And people tend to forget that part, that it's not like, hey, listen, do you need a writer? No? Okay, cool. I'll check back with you next year. Mm-hmm. It's like, I don't remember what happened last month, much less what happened last year.
Right. And if you're writing all the time anyway, whether you have a gig or not, whether you're writing on your site or you're funny on Twitter, I mean, I remember that stuff, you know. I mean, like you said, it just sort of gets in there and you're like, "Oh, remember that guy? He'd be good for this particular story."
Would you recommend someone trying to break in a little bit or trying to get a semi-paid gig, whatever you want to call it, you know, to write on Medium? I feel like that feels like the platform for a lot of people to, like, at least online, there's people, I call it scraping, because there's some trash, like, kind of sites out there that'll pull these rookie writers up from there. That I guess I've read on. I try to read about it on Reddit, because we have a friend that's been writing a lot on there, and I was like, "Huh, I wonder how many people do that path." And I guess there's a lot of sites out there that just aggregate as much as they can.
Yeah,
and they don't really care about a lot of stuff, but they're getting a lot of free labor essentially.
Yeah, that's exactly what it is. I don't actively read Medium looking for new writers for Creative Loafing, because basically, I mean, honestly, we're not looking for new writers.
No, you got a big supply. Like, you've got people wanting to work there. And we talk about that with employment for a lot of our clients, is like, be the place that there's a waiting list. You know, be the place that there's a lot of people hitting you up wanting to work there. Mm. And that's a culture y'all have created.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I want, as soon as I moved here, that was one of my goals, was to write for Creative Loafing.
Yeah.
Back when it was the Weekly Planet.
By the way, huge fan since the Weekly Planet. Just throwing awesome. That Thank out there, you. FYI. It's just one of those things that it's like, you know, you see it, whether you're in the coffee shop, whatever the case, it's the first one I pick up.
Definitely
you know.
Catches Thank your you. Eye.
It's part of the community, and I'm really proud of that. I've been a part of that since 2001, and I'm really happy to be a part of it.
My favorite was the comedy issue.
So well, see, that's
so how we got
Why, because you were in it?
I've got it framed actually right behind me, which I feel douchey.
Yeah, a little.
I can actually reach out and touch it right now if I want.
It feels like I'm wearing the band shirt and going to the concert.
Yeah.
I realized halfway through this
How's
interview.
How's that bad?
It just feels weird that, hey, oh, like I put it here. Like, oh, remember this? Like, remember when you came in the office? One thing I did remember about, all right, so I'll give the backstory. I got super pissed that there wasn't, not super pissed, but just perturbed. There was 40 issues of Artisan Coffee and then 15 slam poetry cover issues. And I just wanted to put...
I don't think we did 15 slam poetry covers.
No, I know. I did count it up, though. I went hard in the paint. I tried to count up, like, how many issues about the Tampa Bay scene of these other arts going on. And there was not one in, like, at whatever point that was 13 years about comedy. And I was like, there's a really good scene here. And I just kind of did my own little douchey kind of like blog post.
Accumulating stats.
Put it out there. Yeah. Well, I'm just like a lawyer about it. If I'm going to have an opinion and I'm going to drive at it, I'm going to have facts to back it up.
Way to turn your nerdy habit into a cool thing.
Data-driven decisions, my friend. That's how you do online advertising.
Right back to nerdy. You shamed us into it. I mean, that's very true.
Ooh.
But it was a fun shame. It wasn't like, hey, guys, you guys are fucking cucks or something like that. It was like, look, what's the deal? No comedy issue. It was kind of fun. And then whoever had your Twitter account was going back and forth in a fun way, too. And then I don't remember from there. You were like, hey, let's do it. You came in here. And I was up all night working on something. I was like, it's 10 a.m., but do you want a beer? And you're like, yes. And I was like, all right, this is going to be cool.
Best friends forever.
Yeah, pretty much.
I knew I liked you for some reason. I was like, wait. Oh, yeah.
It's
yeah,
the morning
cool.
beers.
One yes. thing that really caught my eye when we were doing the interview is that it really kind of, after you left and I thought about it later, was you had to interview while typing at the same time. Which is kind of a crazy multitasking kind of thing. And I thought about it. I was like, you had to get to that point.
Yeah.
I don't think that was your deal growing up, right?
No, like, not everybody does it. But I have so much to do that we don't have a transcription service. So
right.
I cannot spend 2 hours combing through an interview that I just had it. Why don't I just have it while I'm having it?
Right. But no, I get it. Like, because I'll do a meeting and I'll go, hey, while I'm doing this meeting, I'm going to be working on something else. And I've developed how to kind of be able to pay attention when I need to during a meeting sometimes. So, like, sometimes it's like someone...
How often does that work with your wife, though?
Never.
Just checking.
But to be fair to me, I tell her I need a pen and a pad if you're going to give me stuff I have to do. Because I need to, like... I don't have a good short-term memory. I know that. But I need... You can't just give me order as like a line chef and just like, hey, table 23 doesn't want the tomatoes on their plate.
That's,
like,
that's a great analogy. Those people can remember everything.
I'm so bad at I know that about myself, you know, like, and I thought about you doing an interview. It's like when we try to direct this and do the podcast, sometimes it's too much multitasking. It takes away from one or the other.
Yeah.
And so I was thinking, you weren't probably born with the ability to do that, you probably just had it out of force. And I always think about, like, you think you're maxed out when you're doing your own thing, or you're in a career where you have to be a self-starter and you have to be motivated and you have to get to that next level on your own. No one's going to pull you up, kind of thing. You'll have mentors and stuff, but no one's going to be like, hey, come on, kid, I saw you. Now you're going to write for Time magazine. Like, that shit's out, right? And so... you have to be super efficient, and you have to be way better at multitasking than you ever thought. And I always call it, like, 6-month plateau. Like, you're like, I look back 6 months, and I was like, man, I thought I was really fucking hustling, and that wasn't shit compared to what's going on right now.
No, you get better at managing your time. Your bag of tools gets bigger, you know, and then, you're able to tackle more stuff.
So are we talking writing the article itself as you're sitting there, or just taking notes?
No, I was transcribing the interview. Oh, you were talking.
That's even crazier. Transcribing it yourself. I thought you just meant you were taking notes. I don't know.
And it almost, the way you type, because you slam like I do, I think.
I'm a really noisy typer.
Caveman typing.
You probably taught yourself how to type.
I actually took typing in...
Really?
Junior high school, I think, was when I first started taking typing.
The problem is that the further back you go, the harder you have to slam on keys because you were working on real typewriters.
Yep. Oh, well, yep. Not typewriter. Well,
yeah. Yes. I learned to type on typewriters.
I learned to type on an IBM.
How old are you, Damian?
I'm fucking ancient, bro.
What's the number? Tell me.
I'm in my 40s.
Cuban don't crack.
Still not that old to have a typewriter.
Well, maybe I just went to a poor school.
Oh, okay. Sorry, this is not going in a good direction.
Wow,
it was poor. Okay.
It also seems like laptops have been around forever, but they haven't. Man, they've only been around what 15 years as far as really usable.
I typed on a typewriter at one point.
Really?
Yeah, we had a family computer, one of those like green screen Apple ones. But
wow,
I poured Coke on it or something.
Well, I mean, all right. So just to not get off subject, but think about this.
Okay.
Did you learn anything on YouTube back in high school?
No, wasn't around.
Exactly. Nowadays, you tell someone, "Hey, man, how do you know how to do that?" They're like, "Dude, YouTube it." That wasn't around just then. You actually remember dial-up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All that shit, right? Do you remember floppies?
Yeah.
All right, dude. Think about how far.
Still get them.
So. So just think about that
just
for
in case they come back. You got a stack of them.
So just think about that for a second. Like your schools probably were like, oh yeah, there may have been laptops out, but then all of a sudden. People and everyone else in large organizations, which turn very slowly, there were fucking Commodores and shit, you know what I mean? And typewriters and stuff like that. And it's like, oh, wow, we finally got a grant to get brand new computers. And they were still
Apple
like twos. 10 years old. So, yeah dude.
That's I believed you. I thought you're old as shit.
Yeah, it's just one of those.
You look younger than us.
Yeah, I know. That's the real problem here. Is I feel like I look like I'm 50. If you look so nice and refreshed all the time.
Yeah.
The nice deep voice.
Nice décolleté too. So
I'm Damian.
I'm working on my décolleté.
So, all right, we got a couple more minutes to close this mother out. Anything? I should have asked you if you had anything you wanted to bring up while you were coming in. I'm bad at the pre-interview stuff.
No, it's good. I like.
Shooting from the
sort
hip.
Of freewheeling style, yeah. What comes up comes up.
What do you see kind of in the future? I guess for how things are going in the industry, or you. I mean, it could even be with what y'all are doing at Creative Loafing. But I know that's hard to kind of. I don't want to put you on the spot like that.
No, I do. I do think that people are gonna, especially you know, younger people that are just coming out of school that are more. Not just want to be writers, but want to be creative and want to tell stories and want to do journalism in a new way. They're going to find some really amazing ways to tell stories. Whether it's coding, video, a combination, like every story could be its own site, you know?
Yeah.
And whereas people 5 or 10 years ago, people used to, lost my train of thought. It used to take months to put together a website. You can put together a website now in a week, you know.
We push everybody to Squarespace. Hey, Squarespace, what's up? Give us a promo code.
Where's the promo code, Squarespace?
Damian, can you do a two-shot over here?
Two-shot, right.
Hey, yeah, Wix. Hey, Wix, here's your opportunity to
Wix is
muscle
garbage.
In.
Garbage-ass
Wix. We're Squarespace lovers. We're going to be the Squarespace Gimlet. Winners of
when do we win the contest?
They're doing a contest. Squarespace and Gimlet Media are doing a contest. Who's the podcast host for them? And we're like, we talk about Squarespace probably every other episode because we work in that Squarespace so much.
Squarespace space. Is that what you almost said?
But we were like. We're like, hey, just give us a promo code, and at least, you know, it'll help incentivize more people over there.
You have your two shots, so if you're going to say something, say it straight to camera.
Hey, Squarespace, Gimlet, we're your new hosts. That's all I want to say, because we're going to cut that. We'll wrap it in an ad.
It was live.
Okay. We'll cut it out. We'll wrap it in an ad. I'll target everybody that works there. I've already done it.
It's creepy, right?
Yeah.
Targeting the zip code of the Gimlet
offices. I looked up their offices, and I looked up where both offices are. I looked up.
He did that.
The ages, age range. Yeah, there's one in Ireland for Squarespace. It's like a 5-story office.
Well, I looked up Squarespace.
Looked up the address, figured it out. I go, okay, probably this range.
It's a podcast on just how much you could cyberstalk somebody these days,
dude. This is like nothing. This is like You can track like people, like you can track like executives if you really want to. I was sharing notes with someone that was telling me they'll go to a trade show. You walk in their little area, their little geo-tagged area. You get on their Wi-Fi without really knowing it because it's open source, so it's just open. And you know how people are like, you shouldn't have, you should always have like a password for it because you don't want anybody to steal your stuff. Think of the opposite.
No, but if you want to, if you want to flip that,
so they, your phones will automatically get to the better version of that Wi-Fi at a trade show or something. Now they got your info. Now they can find. Now they got your low jack of a phone. They follow you all the way to your house. Now they got your address, basically. They can figure out where you live. Then they'll send you a packet over there.
Who's they?
The
who should
the
I be watching out for?
Future law. Future. They
people
is
like
future
me,
law.
People like me that really want to target. If you wanted to target C-level executives or really hard to get to, kind of.
What
like
if we're below sea level? What if we live in Denver? We're above sea level.
You could technically use that technique to start sending issues directly to advertisers' homes. Just be like, "Bam! Here you go."
A super
potential
high
end potential advertisers.
Yeah,
sounds really efficient.
It'd have to be all about like that. Would be the right wing alternative newspaper, really. If it's all executives,
stoke the fear.
Yeah, but so you—that's the crazy shit. That's account-based marketing. That's integrated marketing. Because it's jumping over different platforms and it's tracking so well, it's scary. Because your phone, that's a low jack. This thing goes, you basically go to work and you go home. Yeah. So you can kind of figure out by deductive logic on IPs.
Which is the home.
Yeah, and which is work. And you can figure, it's fucking creepy. Because these phones, you can't customize the way you want all the time. You can have a lot of security on it, but what are you going to do? Walk around with a VPN all the time? You won't get. It'll be hard to like do anything. So, anyway,
I have a quick question.
We're not a rant.
I have a quick question. So, stories, right? How do you decide on your stories? And would there ever come a time because as you start to move away from paper, would there ever come a time where you simply, you know, have your writers vet your stories and maybe even have contributors? That are like, this is a creative loafing contributor, not a writer, so you're not exclusive, you're a contributor, which means that you can supply a story, and if we like it, we'll post it. So it's kind of like, they're giving like exclusives or anything like that. Is there anything of that kind of organic nature? Yeah, crowdsourcing type nature that could still offer, you know, kind of an end, but still allow your writers to, you know, obviously have the exclusive, and then, you know, like I'm just kind of curious about that. I know we're running out of time, but I was just kind of curious as to how do you pick the story, and then how do you decide what content you want to actually go forward with?
Most of the content that we post online on a day-to-day basis just sort of comes across our transom through Twitter, RSS feeds, what the other papers in town, the stories they're working on. And then there's stuff that we always have in the hopper that's sort of dictated by time of year it is. You know, the elections are coming up, so we're talking to all the local politicians, and that stuff that can go out. You know, we can work on that over the course of a week or something. It doesn't have to be that day, but we're doing a lot more stuff that's just quick turnaround stuff for the web while we're working on longer form pieces for the paper. And as far as contributors go. I don't see creative loafing ever like going to like the patch model where there's a lot of people contributing, because at the end of the day, we're a newspaper and we're responsible for what gets printed or what gets posted, and it has to go through one of our editors or through me. We have section editors instead of writers on staff who also write, but they're also editors in charge of their own channels, music, food, A&E, and we don't have a news editor anymore. We lost her. Sorry, Kate. Hope you're doing well. We miss you.
Shout out to Kate.
But we work with contributors that we trust, and like we'll give them the keys to our CMS, but they can't publish anything unless one of us has looked at it and vetted it. And it's part of a time consuming process, but at the end of the day, we want to put out quality news, and so we have to maintain some sort of not like a snobby thing, but just there has to be a protocol.
You need quality control.
Yeah,
and that's good. It's actually refreshing to hear someone in your industry kind of talk about that, because it's not really talked about at all. From someone there, right? From someone inside.
Well, it's funny because you live in this bubble and you think everybody knows how your sausage gets made, and a lot of people really don't. You know, they just read the sausage.
Oh God, yeah.
Just read the sausage.
Just reading sausage.
New
all
creative
day.
Loafing tagline.
Veiny sausage. So I've got a heart out in about 2 minutes, but the one thing I did want to bring up, we're very fortunate to have you running the show over at Creative Loafing and Tampa Bay Times is two very good. I would trust both of them. I trust your kind of what you just went over quality control wise, y'all's voices, in an era which is misinformation, disinformation.
Mm-hmm.
And then the other thing I had is my thing with y'all going forward, I think interactive kind of blogs, interactive kind of articles, we don't have enough time for it, but I think on the web-based side, the engagement level will change according to, you're going to have to kind of code articles a little bit. It's going to have video.
Yeah.
It's going to have some kind of engagement graph. You see it with USA Today on a broad spectrum. They do a very good job of, infographic kind
was
of
it the colors. Was it the Times or the Post that did the one about Florida hurricane season? They did like a whole separate site. And it was gorgeous. I mean,
right.
It was all animated graphics and like live animated infographics that popped in and out. It was beautiful. Hopefully you'll get to a point where you can do that in a couple of days instead of 4 months.
We could do it. but that display advertising model, that system that everybody's used to of seeing their newspaper when it went to web, where it's just overloaded and it lags and all this shit, it's going to go out the door.
I agree.
And display like that's kind of dying a little bit, and I see that trend going down. Whereas you'll see more co-branded stuff. Hey, this section, this part of the hurricane's brought to you by a Home Depot.
Yeah.
Come get your plywood.
Yeah, we're already experimenting with content marketing, and I mean that's not my side of things. There's still a firewall up between ads and
yeah.
But we're experimenting with branded pieces that are very obviously marked as branded or sponsored.
Yeah,
or
that's
whatever.
Good.
So
for all,
it's not a trick. That's nice.
Yeah.
For all my nerds out there, when are we going to get the Harry Potter version of Creative Loafing where the pictures move? Right in the paper.
I would love that. That would be amazing.
I had to put that in there for my nerds out there.
I think
we want it.
I think the only thing that we can get to still is like the baseball card where there's two poses.
Yeah, hologram.
When you're looking at it. But someday soon, I'm sure.
Yeah, dope.
Yeah. The hologram. The Tops
Fleer.
Whatever it is. Thanks for coming on, man.
Thank you, Damian,
you were thinking Marvel Comics cards, weren't you?
I was. Yeah. I was Marvel Comics with Harry Potter.
I had them all too, dude.
I was like, what the hell is that card you're talking about?
Thanks for keeping it girthy, y'all. iTunes, Apple Podcasts, Spotify, YouTube, Vimeo, LinkedIn, Facebook.
SweatEquityPod.com.
We're on all that. Hit us up, comment. We'll probably bring it up on the show.